Thank you for watching this video from KingswaySoft. Today, I will be introducing the components for HTTP web services from within the SSIS Productivity Pack. The SSIS Productivity Pack is a collection of premium SSIS components which enable greater developer productivity and increases the power of SSIS. The HTTP web services components connect to virtually any HTTP URLs or SOAP-based service endpoints to read or write data. As of this recording, there are 6 components. The HTTP Connection Manager can be used to establish HTTP connections. The Web Service Source is a data flow component that can be used to read or retrieve data from a SOAP web service URL. The Web Service Destination is a data flow component that can be used to execute operations of a SOAP web service URL. The Web Service Task is a control flow component that can be used to read or retrieve data from a SOAP web service. HTTP Requester is a data flow component that can be used to send a series of HTTP requests and process the responses. This component can take input data from upstream components and use them as query string parameters. HTTP Requester Task is a control flow component that can be used to send an HTTP request and receive a response. For the purpose of this demonstration, we will begin with the HTTP Connection Manager. All other components require the HTTP Connection Manager to be established first. From there, we'll show you how to configure the Web Service Source, Web Service Destination, and Web Service Task. Afterwards, we will demonstrate the HTTP Requester component for downloading a series of files. Following that, we will show you how to configure the HTTP Requester Task to send an HTTP request. Please note that you will be finding many similarities between all these components. Let's start by right-clicking the Connection Manager area. We will select the HTTP Connection Manager and press Add. We are now prompted to enter the server information, starting with the base URL that you would like to connect to. The HTTP method specifies how you would access the URL. There are 3 options available: get, post, and delete. In this instance, we will select post. Next is the authentication area, in which you can enter a domain with username and password. You would only fill in this area if this is applicable to your instance. The Use Client Certificate option specifies if a client certificate will be used when accessing the URL. By enabling this option, the certificate button will be available for us. This will then allow us to choose our certificate from the currently installed client certificates. The timeout option is defaulted to 120 seconds. You can also specify the chunk size to use when sending web requests. If chunking will not be used, you can set the size to 0. Note that in the advanced settings, there is an optional proxy server setting in the case where a proxy may be required. We also have an option to retry in intermittent errors. This option is intended to help recover from possible intermittent outages or disruption of service, so that the integration does not have to be stopped due to temporary networking issues. This option has been designed to retry up to 3 times. Lastly, the custom header section can be added to web request. Before we hit OK, we should test the connection to make sure our information is correct and we can connect successfully. Please note that the connection manager that we just created is a package level connection manager. For SSIS 2012 or later, you can create project level connection managers if you right-click the Connection Managers node within the Solution Explorer. Next, we will begin a data flow task to illustrate the next 2 components, Web Service Source and Web Service Destination. Let's start by dragging the Web Service Source component from the SSIS toolbox to the data flow design surface. Double-click it to configure its editor form. As mentioned before, the Web Service Source component allows us to read or retrieve data from a web service. Let's select an HTTP Connection Manager. Source WSDL specifies the location of the WSDL that you might have, which can be either a location on the file system or a URL. This is to help generate SSIS metadata from the service endpoint. The Next button will let you select a file from the file system. Once the source WSDL is specified, you can click on the button to load WSDL. This will populate all the fields available for the service endpoint based on the WSDL file provided. The next part allows us to select a service, binding, and operation that is contained in the web service. The input parameters grid will be populated with a list of parameters of the input message and their types. We can enter values for each parameter. We can also add custom SOAP headers in the next grid. Custom SOAP headers can be added in the headers column, and any namespaces referred to by the headers can be added in the namespaces column. By clicking the Refresh Component button, we can update to the latest metadata of the chosen WSDL file. Now let's navigate to the columns page, where there is a list of names and types of all available output columns. These columns are from the operation we specified on the general page. The columns page shows the field name, which is the column that will be retrieved from the service endpoint, and the column's data type. We can click OK to finish configuring the source component. Now let's add a flat file destination component and connect the two. This will demonstrate the data we retrieved from the web service. We can now execute the task successfully. Now I will demonstrate the web service destination component. Before we configure the destination component, we must first establish a source. I will use the data spawner component as my source and quickly configure three columns for email address, subject, and body. Let's drag the web service destination component from the SSIS toolbox to the design surface and connect the two. As mentioned before, this web service destination component is used to execute operations of a web service. It can technically talk to virtually any SOAP-based service endpoint to process requests or write data to the target system. As you can see, the web service destination component is similar in function to the web service source component. Let's select an HTTP connection manager. Source WSDL specifies the location of the WSDL for the web service, which can be either a location on the file system or a URL. The next button will let you select a file from the file system. Once specified, we can load the WSDL to populate all the input fields available for the service endpoint based on the WSDL file provided. Now we can select service, binding, and operation options contained within the web service. We can also add custom SOAP headers in the next grid. Custom SOAP headers can be added in the headers column, and any namespaces referred to by the headers can be added in the namespaces column. By clicking the Refresh Component button, we can update to the latest metadata based on the WSDL file provided. Navigating to the columns page, we have a list of names and types of all available output columns. This page allows you to map the columns from upstream components, such as the data spawner, to the component fields. For each row of input data, the web service will be called once. We can now head to the error handling page, where there are three error handling mechanisms to choose from. The default option is fail and error, where the entire data flow will fail as soon as an error occurs. There is also the redirect rows to error output, where the error output will contain the failed records with some extra columns, such as error code, error column, and error message. There is also a third option, which is to ignore any errors that may have occurred. Click OK to finish configuring this web service destination component. We can now execute the task successfully. I will now demonstrate the web service task, which is a control flow component that can be used to read or retrieve data from a web service. Let's select an HTTP connection manager. Similar to the previous components for web service source and destination, we must specify a source WSDL, which is the location of the WSDL for the web service. As mentioned before, this can be either a location on the file system or a URL. Once specified, we'll load the WSDL file. Next, we can select the service, binding, and operations contained in the web service. The input parameters grid will be populated with a list of parameters of the input message and their types. We can enter values for each parameter. We can also add custom SOAP headers in the next grid. Custom SOAP headers can be added in the headers column, and any namespaces referred to by the headers can be added in the namespaces column. Lastly, the response body output determines what will happen with the response body with the following three options available. None, when the response body will not be used for anything. Output to variable, which will download the response and save it to the chosen variable that can later be used. Output to file will enable you to save the response body to a file. The last page is the error handling page, where we can choose to continue on error. If this is enabled, a warning will be fired when an error occurs, while the package execution continues. We can now execute the task successfully. We will now focus on the HTTP requester component. In our example, we will download files using this component. As mentioned before, the HTTP requester is a data flow component that can be used to send a series of HTTP requests and process the responses. This component maps column data from a data source to HTTP request. We must first establish an HTTP connection manager for the purpose of downloading files or processing HTTP requests. Now let's create a new HTTP connection manager, but this time we will use the get method for the download purpose. For clarity purposes, I will rename this connection manager to HTTP get. I'm going to add a flat file source component. Now let's drag the HTTP requester component from the SSIS toolbox to the design surface and connect it to the flat file source component. We will select the previous connection manager, HTTP get. This is the connection manager where we select the get as the HTTP method. Note that the flat file that we use as a source contains two input columns. They are relative path and file path. We will be using the relative path as the URL for the HTTP request and the file path as the output to receive the downloaded file. Since we are downloading files using the get method, the body field can be left unmapped. You can now add query string parameters and values that will be appended to the URL of the request. There is also the enable columns for default output section, where you can determine if these two output columns for content type and content length will be created and populated on the default output. Next, you can determine what will happen to the response body in the response body output. There are four options available: none, output to image column, output to text column, and output to file. The last page is the error handling page, where there are three error handling mechanisms to choose from. The default option is fail on error, where the entire data flow will fail as soon as an error occurs. There's also the redirect rows to error output, where the error output will contain the failed records with extra columns, including error code, error column, and error message. There is also a third option, which is to ignore any errors that may have occurred. There is also the enable columns for error output section, which you can use to enable or disable the additional column in the destination component's error output, HTTP status code, HTTP status code name, and response body error. These error columns provide additional information as to why the request failed. We can now execute the task successfully. Lastly, we will show you the HTTP requester task for the specific purpose of sending an HTTP request and processing its response. As mentioned before, the HTTP requester task is a control flow component. A popular use case for this component is to download a file or process an HTTP request. In this demo, we will show you how to send an HTTP request using the HTTP requester task. Let's first create an HTTP connection manager, but using the post method this time. We will be showing you how to add a custom header function in the HTTP connection manager. For clarity purposes, I will rename this connection manager to HTTP post. Double-click it to open its editor form. We will select the previous connection manager, HTTP post, in where we selected post as the HTTP method. The relative path field allows you to specify a string containing the relative URL path the request will be sent to. This relative URL will be combined with the base URL from the connection manager. We will specify a relative path. Since we are sending an HTTP request using the post method, we can enter the body of the request. There are three formatting options: plain text, JSON, and XML. I will select the XML option. You can now add query string parameters and values that would be appended to the URL of the request. Next, you can determine what will happen to the response body in the response body output. Similar to the web service task, there are three options: none, output to variable, and output to file. The last page is the error handling page where we can choose to continue on error. If this is enabled, a warning will be fired when an error occurs while the package execution continues. We can now execute the task successfully. This concludes the demonstration of our HTTP web services components within our SSIS Productivity Pack. There are many other components in the SSIS Productivity Pack that enable developers to accomplish more in SSIS in a much more productive fashion. Please feel free to take a look at our other videos available for viewing on our website or YouTube channel. Thank you for watching this video. For any additional questions, please feel free to reach out to us.